Okay, welcome everybody to this afternoon's webinar from Deafblind Information Australia. I am Melanie Robartson and your presenter today is Emma Neckes. Our webinar today is Mealtimes for Children with Vision and Hearing Impairment, Creating Everyday Eating and Drinking Routines. I would also like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we are presenting from today, the Turrbal and Yagara people, and where Emma is, and myself, the Wajak people. We pay respects to their elders past and present, as well as the peoples from all around the country from which our audience joins us. I'm excited to have Emma with us today. She is a speech pathologist and international board certified lactation consultant, and she's based in Brisbane. She is the clinical lead for speech pathology for National 360 and is the owner and director of Feed and Grow. Emma has been supporting children and their families to develop their eating and drinking skills for the last 20 years in the UK, New Zealand, and Australia. Welcome, Emma. I'm going to hand over to you.
Thank you, Melanie. Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be here and to give a little window into working and creating mealtimes for children with vision and hearing impairment. And we're going to focus today, as we've said, on creating routines and some strategies to hopefully help the audience. I'm aware we have a range of professionals, parents, and other people in the audience today. So please feel free to ask questions at the end to ask for any clarification with the more complex parts. So, just an overview of what we'll be covering today. We'll be having a brief discussion on how eating and drinking skills develop. We'll discuss deafblindness and the team around the child. We'll discuss the different needs of children who have limited access to sight and sound. We'll discuss some of the adjustments for children with deafblindness that provide equal access to mealtime experiences. And one of the overarching aims of this presentation today is to help create a daily routine that encourages development of mealtime skills. Because eating and drinking is a central part of everyone's day. And so when we discuss therapy and support and key strategies, these, I believe, should fit within your everyday as opposed to a standalone activity. So with that in mind, let's begin. So even before a baby is born, we know that they are sucking and swallowing inside their mothers in the womb. And actually from 36 weeks from conception, babies are able to coordinate sucking and swallowing and breathing, which is an essential skill for early feeding. And for early feeding, 0 to 6 months, the focus is on milk as baby's main form of nutrition, be that from a breast, from a bottle, or from babies with complex needs, potentially even a feeding tube. The World Health Organization still advocates for breastfeeding up to 6 months, and then in the introduction of solids at this point. Okay. So when we're thinking about starting solids, from 4 to 6 months, tongue movements and oral skills start to change. And this is the key with children when considering when we should be starting solids. It's not really the number, it's whether they are ready to. So do they have the oral skills they need to try eating foods other than drinking milk? And then we follow their oral skills and we expand on them with different foods and different textures as they start to learn more about food. And one of the key parts of starting solids and transitioning is observation and interaction with adults and their peers who are also eating and drinking. and we'll discuss this a little later, but you can start to see how children with limited vision or access to sound may be impacted and not be able to learn in the same way. And so we need to think of how we're going to create opportunities for them to access their world, even from this very early age. So as I mentioned, until 12 months of age, milk remains a central source of nutrition. And we now know that solids should be, or ideally are presented in that time for variety and to increase those textures as babies learn to tolerate them. I often say to the families I work with that it's easier to introduce variety earlier on. It's easier to introduce a variety earlier and then build volumes of food later. But if you try and do it the other way around and focus too much on one food, then often it's more challenging to develop a variety and a range later in life. Okay. So when we're thinking about solids and upwards, from 2 years, children will continue to fine-tune the skills they have learned, but they'd have laid down a really solid foundation for eating a variety of foods. And as time progresses, they become more of an active participant in mealtimes, such as feeding themselves, being able to make choices and show likes and dislikes. And these patterns will persist into adulthood. All these experiences contribute to this learning and establishment of lifelong patterns, which impacts the range and oral skills of all children as they grow and learn around mealtimes. And there's some evidence that argues a window of opportunity that if you're not exposed to key foods before 24 months, then it's much harder, but not impossible, to do it later. The references for these parts are at the end of the slides. So again, from age two and upwards, children want more control in what and when they eat until they build understanding of expectations in different environments. And this kind of equates to feeling safe and secure and being able to predict what's going to happen. Again, when we start to think of children who may have difficulties with vision or hearing, you can see how that might be a challenge as well. Hopefully from age two and upwards, children become more adventurous and they have a willingness to try new foods, which might increase if they've had a strong foundation. They're more likely to try a bigger range of sensory experience linked to new temperatures or textures of food. And I think this is often interwoven with the development of social skills because children are more aware of what their peers and other adults are doing. And those social skills are starting to develop and eating can become more of a social activity. Emotional and social development also increases. And as I mentioned before, this goes hand in hand with seeking new experiences, which can impact on mealtimes. Children will often want to attempt and try to use forks and spoons and other implements more independently. And this can mean mealtime mess is a normal activity and totally appropriate until those skills are achieved. So we've very briefly discussed kind of a little bit around the patterns of development in eating and drinking from babies to toddlers and then into the older child. So now we've considered how these skills develop. Now we need to think about how do we understand the child that has limited access to vision or hearing? And how do we understand the team around that child? So another term we use here is deafblindness. So worldwide, the World Federation for Deafblindness indicates that deafblind people make up between 0.2% and 2% of the population. And it's important to remember that there's many different combinations of hearing and vision difficulty which children may present with. For example, some may have some functional hearing and some functional vision. Some may have some functional vision but no functional hearing. Some may have functional hearing but no functional vision. And some children may be totally deaf and blind. Um, Deafblindness is described also in Australia as a unique and isolating sensory disability resulting from the combination of both hearing and vision loss or impairment. And this can have a significant effect on communication, socialization, motility, mobility, and daily living. And as we start to build a picture of normal development in children and mealtimes, you can start to see the elements of how children learn that may be impacted by this. And so then we need to start considering how we can compensate and provide different opportunities for these children. So when we think about deafblind diversity, as I've mentioned before, there's varying levels. There's varying age of onset, and we'll see that in some of the case studies that we talk to later in this presentation. There's often possible additional disabilities which also impact. And this can make it slightly confusing because you might work with a child, for example, that has vision, but their brain isn't able to process or translate the images to make sense to them, such as in cortical visual impairment, for example. And all these children with varying levels of vision and hearing and with additional disabilities will receive levels of specialist support unique to their needs. So when we start working with this caseload, it's important to consider each child individually and to make sure you have all the information before you begin. So where do you begin is the question. As I've mentioned just now, it's really important to get the best possible understanding of the child's level of hearing and vision when starting to work with their mealtime management. We're seeking to understand how they use or don't use each sense. Are some senses heightened and some senses dulled? Are they heightened to the point where it's uncomfortable at mealtimes? And we'll talk a little bit more about other professionals that look at that kind of sensory side of things in a little while. As I mentioned, some children will have other disabilities too. These children and their families will need a range of supports from a team of different specialists and professionals. It will always be a team approach. So we need to gather information such as professionals involved, history of anything that's happened to that child, and previous reports about hearing and vision. And the key message here is to ask. Firstly, ask the parents. You can also ask the child if they're able. Have a think about different allied health providers and gather information from all those involved in the family and the child's life. And keep asking because things might change and it's really important to keep up to date. Obviously, we need to be mindful of consent, so make sure you have permission from everyone involved in the family's care and the parents to share information right at the beginning when you start working with them. And if you're a parent here today listening, just making sure that you're happy with the amount of information that professionals are sharing and to ask or discuss if you're not. Okay, oops, I went the wrong way. Excuse me. So let's take a moment to think about the team around the child. The parent and child aspects are central to all aspects of mealtime management. And we should always be considering individual circumstances. The parents and the child's values and cultures should always be considered and taken into account. It's really important to consider that some statistics tell us that 48 to 85% of children with feeding difficulties have two or more conditions, and these might be developmental, behavioural, or medical. And so it's really important to consider the individual at the centre of creating a mealtime routine and know their individual needs. And also, again, to parents who might be watching this today, to have a think, what's unique about your child? What do they need in their routine to make them feel comfortable and safe with eating and drinking? And what have you tried that's worked before? And all those kinds of things. So I popped a few key members of the team in these slides, and I apologize in advance if I've missed anyone. It'll be interesting in our Q&A, please do sing out if I've missed you off this list. So we've discussed the parents and the children. There's speech pathologists just such as myself who have specific training in eating and drinking support. And we work closely looking at all the aspects of eating and drinking and mealtime management. So this includes looking at the phases of eating and swallowing. So looking at how children approach food and bring food to their mouths, how they might take a bite or accept food in their mouth, how they get that food ready in their mouth for swallowing, and how safe their swallow is. So do things go down the right way, or is there a risk of aspiration where food may end up in the airway and ultimately in the child's lungs, which can make them quite sick, which we know as aspiration. We work closely with all the other professionals in that child's care to make sure that any aspiration risk is managed. And our goal is to reduce that risk and increase positive mealtime experiences. Because as we mentioned previously, eating and drinking and mealtimes are a series of patterns which are laid down. So if you have a negative pattern laid down, so for example, you gag and choke at meals, this might make you reluctant to try new foods. Or you might need to develop some oral skills so you can manage more complex foods, which then will help you move on and increase your variety and independence at meals. We work really closely with occupational therapists who work with fine motor skills and sensory processing. So that idea of how all the different senses and the child's body works together to regulate and respond to stimulus. They might support with utensils and equipment, for example, helping bring food to the mouth, increasing independence. We often work alongside dietitians, looking at nutrition as a whole and mealtime management in partnership together. I've just covered the occupational therapist side of things. We also work really closely with physiotherapy to support movement, coordination and balance. And we'll be looking at building strength and posture and agility in the appropriate space. So for example, we might advocate for a well-supported seat for a child so they can reduce that aspiration risk by focusing all their energy and abilities on safe chewing and swallowing. But then we might create a therapy program where they have to walk to the cupboard at the beginning to get the food, which helps them work on their physical skills as well as getting them ready for mealtime. But we'll discuss that a little more later. Again, we all work in partnership. So the physiotherapist will work in partnership with the occupational therapist around appropriate positioning and supporting seating for mealtimes. A few other team members which may exist in this child's team, depending on their needs, will be medical oversight from a paediatrician, support with mealtime behaviours or other behavioural and psychological emotional needs, which will be a psychologist, teachers if they go to school, or early childhood teachers, or teachers of the deaf, for example, which I mentioned later in this slide. They may have a deafblind consultant, orthoptist, audiologist, orientation and mobility specialist, technology specialist providing access, and as I mentioned before, some specialist teachers. This isn't an exhaustive list, so as I said at the beginning, it's really important to consider the individual circumstance of every child that we work with. So when we're thinking about all the senses and sensory impairment and the impact it has on mealtimes for children that may have challenges with vision and hearing, or different access to sight and sound, what are the additional considerations we need to think about? We think about what senses can I use to get what information? Do we need to support vision and hearing access in some way? Or do we need to use another sense to compensate for the vision and hearing being absent? All these things impact on the child's ability to orientate themselves to their surroundings. So thinking, where am I? Where are you? What is going on? How do we compensate for that? How do we provide alternative access? What can we use in the child's setting to help them? This area is particularly why I advocate, I think, for more naturalistic therapy and working in the child's environment, as opposed to taking them out of that setting, which obviously sometimes is necessary should they be in hospital or the professionals work in, say, a feeding clinic. But we should always be considering, how can we orientate to the child's usual surroundings, not the therapy setting? And thinking about how these children develop concepts and communication, which senses are they using and which senses can we use to help them learn? So I apologise in advance for the next three slides. They're visually challenging, but I will describe them, as I just wanted to give an example of the different ways that information is displayed and how you might need to find it. Because as I said, the beginning of working with any child or understanding any child's needs in the mealtime setting is to understand their hearing and vision needs as well. So this is a paediatrician's letter, and you can see the key information for this child is actually down towards the bottom, 0.4, bilateral conductive hearing loss with bone conduction hearing aid. And number 9, limbal dermoid partially covering the right iris. And she has corrective glasses and ongoing ophthalmology review. We'll talk a little bit more about Zoe later, because while she has a bone conduction hearing aid, she refuses to wear it, which you wouldn't know by looking at this letter. This is another example. This is another child. And this came with a cover letter saying, see attached notes for details of appointment. Now, I'm not very good with this handwriting either. So, and some of the terminology is a bit confusing. I don't know what VSM towards the bottom of the page means. Lenses attempted, I think that says. So this just raises the point of asking if you're not sure. And I don't think any question is unimportant, as long as at the end result, the goal is to understand the child's vision and hearing abilities. And this one is an example of an occupational therapy report. Again, apologies for the size of the font. And you can see this has the section at the bottom, which details how the child's hearing and vision has occurred. And this is a child that has an acquired issue, but at a very young age. Okay, we'll move on. So we've set the scene a little bit here. We've talked about the things you need to know when you're considering how to build your routine. And so you have all this information. So now what strategies and ways can we build routines for these children with different access to vision and sound? In terms of eating and drinking needs in these children, as I mentioned earlier, we know around 48 to 85% of children with feeding difficulties have two more underlying conditions. And we know that the more complex feeding difficulties by their nature are multifaceted. They have many parts to them. So therefore, in the back of our mind, we need to think about that feeding is a highly complex task and that we need to unpick each child's journey. And mealtime management needs to consider the physical, so oral skill development, filling missed opportunities, behavioural feeding therapy, which I'll explain in a moment, and the child's sensory needs. And you can see how all the team members I've discussed previously will come together to help with this routine. So thinking on the behavioural side of things, because your speech pathologist and medical professionals will have set tasks and strategies around maybe the more physical or structural elements. Remembering that a lot of early eating and drinking and later skills are reinforced by the environment and the patterns these children lay down in terms of their confidence and safety around eating and drinking. For example, a child may not want to eat more solid foods because they're scared of choking or they don't like how they feel in their mouth. And they may have had negative associations with eating and drinking in the past, such as tube feeding, pressure to eat, children often who are slow to put on weight and grow. Solids are seen as a way of helping that process speed up, but that can lead to unintended pressure. If eating and drinking has always been a stressful time for them and their families. So mealtime routines really need to at their base think about establishing positive patterns and creating positive learning opportunities around eating and drinking. Children with limited access to sight and sound need consistent, predictable routines at each mealtime, and this can help any child feel secure and support active participation. And this is why, as I said, I believe mealtime routines need to be considered in their everyday environment, because I think it's really hard to learn a skill in a different environment and generalize it over without someone supporting that process. So always consider that as well. How am I going to take the skills I've learned today and put them in my everyday life? There are specific approaches which focus on systematic desensitization, which is that idea of working through some of the roadblocks to trying foods and expanding variety in children's diets, and support to children at the more complex end of the scale who may be really aversive to solid food and not want to eat anything or drink anything at all, and have restricted oral intake as a result of that. Some of these children will be so severe in their aversions that they're reliant on alternative feeding methods such as NG tubes or gastrostomies. That's a little bit outside of the scope of this presentation, but I'm happy to talk about that in Q&A or to be contacted outside of this, although I will touch on it slightly. So when we're thinking about creating our mealtime routine, I'd like to think of the key elements of any mealtime focus: access, safety, nutrition, and future skill development. And this is a cyclical process because we're always learning and growing. And one of these elements influences the other throughout childhood and into adulthood, I believe. And this is the structure I've chosen to kind of help share today's information around creating mealtime routines. And they're particularly relevant for children with limited access to sight and sound, but I think they also go for any child who you're trying to create a mealtime routine with. When we're thinking of access for children with limited access to sight and sound, we first need to consider the environment and how this impacts on them. What's the light level? How consistent are objects and placement around the table in the room? Do we need to do some sensory inputs to calm the child before we can expect them to fully engage in the eating and drinking process? Again, we always use a team and a multi-sensory approach here. And so you'll know from the research you've done with the child's parents about how they use their different senses, their level of vision and hearing, and what strategies the team around them have recommended to help them be able to focus on the mealtime, to feel comfortable and safe. Again, we look at positioning. Mealtimes are not the place to be practicing sitting on a stool or sitting without support. The focus of a mealtime ideally will be on the mealtime and chewing and eating and drinking skills, for example, not on sitting in space. For children that don't have an adequate level of support in their bodies, I often ask parents to sit on a chair and take their feet off the ground and feel how unstable that makes you feel. So if we're not providing adequate positioning for children, it can be really challenging. What supports do we also need to put in place to help children access mealtimes that compensate for senses that maybe may not be providing that information? This can include things like touch cues or visual clues, and other feeding supports. And we'll touch on those a little bit later. We may look at utensils that they're using, and specific adaptations for their vision and hearing needs, such as contrast, how we can use different utensils to build the skills that we want, and ultimately keeping the child safe during mealtimes, whether that them feeling safe around food or physical chewing and swallowing and managing aspiration risk. And our goal is always to support active participation in mealtimes. There's a really lovely page from Perkins that I've referenced on the bottom of this slide, which has some really nice adaptations for mealtimes for children with cognitive visual impairment, which is when they often do have functional vision, but the brain can't translate the images that it's seeing. this reference is also at the end of the presentation. When we're considering safety, we need to plan for specific needs. What textures can this child manage well? What do we need to think of in terms of compensatory and safe swallowing strategies? We want to promote safe skill development in context and with appropriate supports that we then remove as the child becomes more competent. So a general rule I say is that 75% of the food and drinks available to the child at mealtimes should be safe and foods that they can manage. And only a small proportion should be challenging. And we might even find that that's too much for the child and we want mealtimes to be safe, and we'll practice eating and drinking outside and bring it into the meal when the skill is developed. But this will be something that your team will work with the child on. When we're working with children with multiple and complex needs, or even children that don't have underlying disability but have challenges or different access to sight and sound, we need to consider the impact of fatigue and the effort that eating and drinking as a task puts on them and manage that appropriately. Again, that's considering how much of a challenge the meal is, and also that over time as the meal progresses, we may need to make things safer for the child that finds it challenging. An example of this is a little one I worked with quite a long time who is predominantly fed by gastrostomy, so a tube that goes directly into the stomach. And they were able to eat puree food from a spoon really easily, and we were practicing chewing. The problem with this child is they fatigue over mealtimes, so we didn't want to do the chewing at the beginning and then them not be able to meet their nutritional needs or to have a positive practice. And so we would give purees at the beginning, a couple of spoons to warm the child up and get them comfortable and used to eating. We'd do a little bit of chewing practice, and then we'd finish with a spoon of puree. What this type of routine does is let you practice the skills, but gives a positive experience. It's predictable because the routine, the order of the foods is always the same, but it allows skill building in a safe space, minimizing fatigue. We need to consider our area of focus when we think about safety and mealtime management. And this often can clash when we think about independence versus a new oral skill learning. Learning to eat independently with a spoon is a really good example of how safety and independence might need to be considered. So eating from a spoon has multiple parts. You need to be able to load the spoon, bring it up to your mouth, take the food off the spoon, move it around your mouth and swallow it, and then put the spoon back down. Now, if this is a texture that you're learning to chew, we need to take all the other noise away. So what we might do is load the spoon and give it to the child for them to put it to their mouth so they can focus on what they're doing with their mouth. And then over time, we'll reduce the supports we give. And this would be in partnership with a professional such as an occupational therapist. As I mentioned earlier, oral feeding may not be the only or safest option for some children, and work with your team around this as there are specific approaches. But the aim of mealtimes is with these children who are not able to fully eat by mouth is to introduce some feeding that is possible and fits in with their social situation and their child and the family's values and needs as well. So we've talked about access and safety, and now nutrition, which is often the focus and also sometimes can clash with that independence and positive mealtime reinforcement, because sometimes children find it hard to eat a range or amount of foods to maximize nutrition, and then they don't gain weight or they don't grow. And also it's really hard to access your daily life if you're not eating enough and you're tired. So the aim with nutrition is optimal for growth and development, but it needs to be in the context of positive mealtime experiences. And this is where dietitians can come in to suggest supplements or supports, or to gain the most value from the foods that the child can eat. And again, we always need to work as a team. So for children with complex needs, nutrition and safety need to occur in partnership and be carefully considered. And last but most definitely not least, as we talked about when we discussed the patterns that children lay down via eating and drinking at every stage of their development and into adulthood, we know that the initial skill building will impact on later oral skill development and later ability to eat and drink foods. As I mentioned before, feeding is a really highly complex task, and we need to unpick each child's journey to understand what's happened in their past journey, which is impacting them now. Patterns are learnt at each stage of eating and drinking. An intervention ideally focuses on the creation of new and functional patterns to support safety and skill building in everyday life. And that's the overarching goal of creating mealtimes routines. We're trying to support safety and skill building in everyday life. And we're looking at how these children access their world slightly differently and use their senses to support this skill development. So again, thinking of some specific equipment that may help us in our journey in eating and drinking, there's many, many, many examples. I've just popped a few here. The cut-up cup, or some people call it the nosy cup, is an example of a cup you can drink from without having to tilt your head. So I'll show you with my cup now. When I drink from this cup, which has a normal lip, I tend to have to tip back. With a nosy cup, which unfortunately I don't have one, you can tip the cup like this and the child's head can stay in the middle, which is super helpful for safety and also gives an instant reward with the liquid. We may use items such as suction bowls and spoons. And you can also see this is a high contrast one. So it's the pale blue with the bright green. So for children with limited vision, having high contrast items might be able to help them see where the spoon is so they can grab it. This will be advised by your occupational therapist and specialist vision support people who can advise whether the type of contrast that your child needs as well. As I mentioned before, good positioning is central to eating and drinking, and there's specialised equipment, especially for children who have multiple disabilities and need a different type of supportive seat. This example is a squiggle chair. And we also talked about using other senses to get ready for eating and drinking, which is where equipment such as a Z vibe might come in. So the routine might be getting the child seated in their supportive chair and then warming up their body and their mouth for eating by using a toy such as a Z vibe, which is it's like a vibrating stick that you turn on at the bottom and give sensory feedback. Again, this will be in partnership with occupational therapy and other team members to make sure it's appropriate for the child. For children that have vision but maybe have limited access to sound, we might use visual aids. So we'll use vision assessment information and vision professionals to help design visual aids that match the child's vision levels. And you can see there's an example here of some visual supports for the stages in eating and swallowing. There's bite, chew, chew, swallow to help practice chewing. And there's also markers on that feeding mat that show where the plate, the spoon, the fork, and the cup go. And this one has some language, because eating and drinking is a multifaceted activity. There's many different things that happen. There's communication, there's eating and drinking, there's the social aspects. So we want to incorporate them all in our supports. An important note when using visual aids, that eyes resting on the target or moving towards a target doesn't necessarily mean the object or the detail is seen or understood. So whilst we need to compensate and understand for this, and that goes back to really understanding your child's vision and hearing needs. And similarly, reaching towards an object does not imply full vision either. And we'll see that in one of the children I'm going to talk about in one of my case examples. Which takes us nicely to some case examples and some videos. Some of these videos were taken on a phone, so they're a little small. But I will play the video and then describe what's happening so you can understand as well, hopefully. So this is an example of a mealtime management plan for a client of mine called Claire. Now, mealtime management plans are a way of recording information that cover all the different areas of support that a child might need. They look at positioning, utensils, textures, access and support, compensatory and safe swallowing strategies, and areas to monitor. This slide was originally an example of a mealtime management plan, but it made the font way too small and was a little bit busy. So I'm just going to talk to you about some of the strategies that would sit under these categories. So example for Claire in her positioning section, there was a series of bullet points that said upright and well supported in her lecky chair. The support person should sit at the same height directly in front of Claire. Ensure when offering the spoon, it is in the middle and Claire's head is upright, not chin down. So under positioning, there were three strategies there. Under utensils was listed a cutout cup and a large contrast plastic spoon. Under the texture section, there was advice around what food and drink Claire was safe to manage, which for her was purees and that she was working towards a minced moist diet. And then under access and support, the key strategies here were Claire needs full assistance at all times when eating and drinking. Give Claire the opportunity to hold the straw bottle or cup as an object of reference to help cue her into how you will be eating and drinking. Objects of reference are specific objects that hold meaning for a task. So giving your child the same cup and spoon to feel before eating and drinking means they start to link that activity to that object. And they're a really good way of mapping your day or your routine. So talk to Claire throughout the experience. Tell her what you see. Try to interpret her movements using simple words and model the language. For example, I think you want more. Oh, finished. Use a touch cue to tap the corner of her mouth and a verbal cue to prompt her to opening her mouth for the drink or food. Touch cues are a really good way of supporting someone to know that food is coming. Claire is a child with significant visual impairment, and I think you can tell by the sort of strategies I'm using, but I didn't mention at the beginning, apologies. So for access and support, Claire needs an object of reference and a touch cue to help her understand what's about to happen and to reduce any negative feedback or startling. We also use tactile prompts, so tapping on her chin and offering an empty spoon to help her swallow and clear her mouth in between each mouthful. So the key access things for Claire under that access and support tab would be objects of reference, touch cues, and using an empty spoon to help her swallow and clear anything that's left over. Claire might have specific safe swallowing strategies and would also have things to monitor based on what her needs might be. So for example, a compensatory or safe swallowing strategy might be limit meal times to 20 minutes due to fatigue, give breaks between mouthfuls, and keep mouthfuls a consistent size. Things to monitor could be check that Claire remains regulated and calm throughout the mealtime. If she becomes upset, take a break and only offer food again if she calms down. This ties in with that philosophy around making sure mealtimes are always a positive and safe experience, because then this will help Claire to progress through them and eat different foods and drinks. The final thing to monitor in Claire's thing to monitor part of her management plan was that her mouth must be checked after the meal to ensure there's no food left in her mouth, especially if she's going to lie down. Because Claire also has other comorbidities, so other conditions, other disabilities. And the risk is when you lie down with food in your mouth, it can go down the wrong way more easily. So these are the headings we might use in a mealtime management plan for a child with complex needs. So we make sure that all areas are covered. And so everyone working with the child understands what they need. This can be really helpful across school and home, for example. So I would ask anyone that works with you to help you create a mealtime management plan, as they can be really useful in this way. And again, having consent to share them. So we're going to look at some videos of some children now. This is Zoe. Zoe is 5. She has a syndrome called Goldenhaar syndrome, which, amongst other things, is characterized by a cleft palate at birth. Zoe's was repaired, so she no longer has a hole in the roof of her mouth. Unfortunately, Zoe became unwell at 7 months, which led to her having a brain injury and cerebral palsy. She has a squint, double vision, and cataracts. She has an absent eardrum on the left side, conductive hearing loss on the right side, and is unable to wear a bone conducting aid due to she just pulls it off. She was referred to the speech pathologist for concerns about coughing, food refusal, and stressful meal times. I'm going to show you a video of Zoe now, and then I'll pause it and talk to that afterwards.
Not burning.
Put it here. Do you know that? No. Yeah. Stick it all the way in.
So you can see several things about the way Zoe isn't eating and drinking here. Firstly, she doesn't have much awareness of how much is on her fork and where it is on her fork. She tends to hug the bowl and bring it close to her because she's not quite sure where it is in space. And she tends to overstuff her mouth, so she puts a lot of food in. And this can be for many reasons. It may be because she's not aware of how much is left in the bowl. It may be that because of the distractions in the environment, she wants to finish eating and be able to get down. But you can see how that filling her mouth so quickly and not chewing and swallowing regularly could lead to food potentially going down the wrong way. This is a video of Zoe drinking. This is the only way Zoe will consume fluid. Again, I'll show the video and talk to it afterwards. Okay, so being that Zoe is 5, it's a little challenging for her that she only feels safe drinking if it's from a bottle and a teat, and she has a bit of an aversion around cups. Again, this may be because she's not had much experience with them, because liquids move fast and may fall on her, and Zoe also has some sensory needs which make mess and food challenging for her. So let's think of areas we want to focus on with Zoe and the goals that we might have for her. So for access, we're going to focus on reducing distraction. We're going to have a more active participation as opposed to a bowl full of food in front of her. So we might portion food out or might ask her to take food and put it in her bowl as an access activity so she's more aware of how much is there. We might introduce some high contrast utensils. And we're going to work with the occupational therapist and physiotherapist around positioning and support and access as well. In terms of her safety with eating and drinking, we're going to work on her chewing skills. You can see that Zoe puts food to the center of her mouth and then swallows. This pattern is further exacerbated by the bottle, which is also a suck to the middle and swallow. So we're going to look at how we can encourage Zoe to put food in her mouth and move it round and around. And we're also going to look at cup drinking because the skills required for cup drinking and managing solid foods go hand in hand. We're going to pace and portion food to reduce overstuffing and also work with occupational therapy to consider what sensory needs are being met here. We might look at the flavour and texture of her food to see if increasing the feedback it gives in her mouth means she is aware that it's there more. And we're going to look at safety and managing her choking risks with the focus on the above. I actually saw Zoe last week and she hasn't had a choking episode since we introduced the pacing and the chewing practice, whereas before she was choking on most meals. And when I say choking, I mean needing an adult to tap her on the back and help her move food as opposed to a gag. So that's been a nice outcome for her. Zoe's goals around nutrition are to increase the variety of food. She's very set in her ways because it's how she feels safe. We need to look at different fluids because cordial as a main fluid source isn't ideal in terms of nutrition and also her teeth. And thinking about how we can make her an active participant in Mealtimes, we're going to help her make choices from family foods as well as the foods that she likes. All this comes together to build some hopefully positive future skills for Zoe. We want to look at independence and positive Mealtimes, positive control, making choices, and also the reduction in choking or challenges at Mealtimes, which then feed into the lesson that eating and drinking is something I feel safe and I enjoy doing and that I want to do. So the key strategies for Zoe in her mealtime routine is to involve her in the food preparation or setup to develop those concepts that eating is about to happen and I've made a positive choice and I've got positive control. Helping her learn to pace by prompting her to wait. We introduced a food tap in between mouthfuls as a cue for that, which Zoe thought was hilarious. We encouraged Zoe to show us all gone between each mouthful and made a bit of a cheer. Bearing in mind the all gone and the cheering is something we do at quiet at home and we don't ask her to do that at school because of the social implications. We've introduced cup drinking as a fun game as opposed to asking her to do it. So we've made the cup a safe place by doing pouring activities, using it in the bath and then taking it in turns to drink from it. And so far we've got as far as 3 sips consistently from a cup, which is a huge step forward for her. We're going to always use positive reinforcement and language, and we're going to focus on the behaviours we want, such as wait, as opposed to the behaviours we don't want, which is don't take more and chew. And bearing in mind that we're compensating for Zoe's challenges and limited sound by using key signing or physically showing her, so saying wait instead of waiting on the verbal word on itself. And we're letting Zoe lead with choices, options, involvement at every step to keep her engaged. And this helps break that refusal cycle we often see with kids, which is, do you want to eat this? No. And Zoe has a predictable routine. We get up, we go to the fridge, we make a choice of 2 foods. We go sit down with the same cup and the same spoon and the same strategies for a mealtime at home. And this helps her feel safe and participate. I often say to families, if the first thing we expect children to do is put food in their mouths, we've lost a whole lot of steps along that journey to make them want to do it. Because the key to any type of mealtime routine is that we want children to want to do it. We're not forcing them to do it or pushing them to do it. We want to teach long-term skills and enjoyment around mealtimes. And this is why we need to compensate for children with reduced access to sound and vision to help make that process a positive one for them. So in order to do this and to work out how these strategies will work with Zoe or any child, we need to think about how do you map your typical day. We need to consider all elements of a mealtime and how we can involve the child in each step. We then need to think about what areas that we need to support to allow them to access, be safe, get adequate nutrition, and to create future skills. And this centers on creating consistent and predictable routine, which everyone involved in that mealtime follows. And we need to make sure we talk to the team to cover all these areas. Now we're going to look at Bella, who is 2. Bella had an acquired brain injury at birth and has cerebral palsy. She has limited access to vision. We're still not entirely sure how much she can see in process. She recently had some surgery on a squint, which means her eyes now focus more on objects, but we're still not quite sure if she can translate what she sees. So Mum and her vision team and myself discuss this as we go along and we share information to see. Because obviously it's challenging with a child this age and with this level of disability to ask them what they see to create the assessment and to get the results. So her vision story is evolving and it's something we need to continually be checking in. So this is Bella. Again, I will play the video and talk afterwards. This video is a really nice example of the visually guided reach that we talked about earlier. That idea that just by looking at object or reaching for it doesn't mean she can necessarily see it or either is effective. You can see she misses it a couple of times. This is the example of Zoe learning to have a drink without many compensatory strategies being used. Now we'll move on to where we introduce some touch cues for Zoe. So here in this video, she's sitting on her mum's lap and mum's offering the cup and talking to her, but she's not really utilizing any other senses. As far as we know, Zoe's hearing is within normal limits, but we don't know, again, how her brain translates what she hears. Sorry, I should have said that at the beginning. Okay. So for the next video, as you can see, even with the still image of Zoe sitting on her lap and her mum about to tap her face, we're going to introduce some cues for her. So I'll play the video and talk to this at the end.
Do you want to have some drink? Good girl.
So I count her in again. One. So you can see here, Bella's sitting on her mum's lap. Mum does a lovely count of 1, 2, 3 by tapping her face. This helps Bella orientate that something's about to happen and actually helps her feel and find the cup more easily, resulting in her taking a sip of the fluid. There's still some things to work on in this picture. We talked a lot about safe positioning for eating and drinking, and whilst Mum is keeping Bella really nice and snug and close to her, which is providing a nice sensory feedback in itself, she's still not well supported. So then we started to look at different chairs, and her occupational therapist organised a specialised seating system for Bella so she could focus on what she was doing with her mouth, not where her body was in space. So as I said, with Bella, the key strategies were looking at positioning, making a chair a happy place for her to eat and drink in, because for children that are not used to eating and drinking in a chair, we need to do a bit of work to make them comfortable. And we looked at orientation and awareness to her utensils, such as cups and spoons. We're trying to manage safe oral skill development, and so we look at increasing the amount she eats with her skills and her stamina. You couldn't see it in this picture because she had pulled it out, but she normally is fed by a tube that goes, an NGT tube, which goes through her nose into her stomach. For Bella, we're looking at balancing oral intake with the tube feeds, and she also has some allergies and intolerances we're trying to manage, which are key to those positive mealtime experiences and teaching her that eating and drinking is safe and something that makes her feel good. When you have an intolerance or an allergy or reflux or vomiting, et cetera, this all adds to that picture that eating and drinking is something which is uncomfortable and we don't want to do. So we're trying to create new positive patterns. That may include for Bella doing positive oral stimulation because she has the negative impacts of having a tube in and out of her nose and the tape that's used to hold that tube in place. And we want to increase her participation independence, but not at the cost of her safety. So this is Bella in her lovely chair, where Mum is using some lovely strategies. So we'll just watch this video.
You want some more, Baba? 1, 2, 3. Yeah. And then like same again, more.
Same again. We'll just go 1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3.
And give the empty one. So the key strategies here were Mum counting her down with that 1, 2, 3 and asking her if she wants more. Because they've used this consistently in every meal and every routine, Bella knows that this means food is coming, so she opened her mouth. And Mum helped her finish what was in her mouth by doing it again, but with an empty spoon, which let her swallow what was left over. There's still a little bit of work here to be done around positioning, but you can see that Bella's a much more calm and interactive participant in the process. We're nearly at the end. A couple more videos and then we'll go to questions. This is an example of Bella's mealtime routine. So before the meal, we have an object of reference, which is a cup or a spoon, which we show her and let her feel in her hands so she knows a mealtime is about to start. We also let her smell the food. So we use smell as a cue that food is there. During the meal, we're going to use a high contrast bowl, verbal prompts, touch cues, and we're going to think about the feedback food gives Bella in her mouth to help her taste and feel it there to give her more feedback. We're now going to talk about the last case study, who is an older child called John. John has optic nerve hyperplasia causing blindness since birth. He also has septo-optic dysplasia insufficiency and has associated feeding and eating challenges, which are fear and sensory based. John doesn't have any other underlying disabilities, but has had a series of choking episodes as he's learned to eat, which has built this fear around eating and drinking. I thought it was really nice to include John because John can tell you what it's like and share his experience. John's goals are that he would like to be able to eat different types of foods and learn how to eat properly by himself. To achieve this, we're going to work with John to develop the range of oral skills to manage chewable foods. John's an example of someone who hasn't developed the skills because he's never been able to try the foods because he's been too scared after a few attempts of trying them. We're going to help him interact with family foods and actively participate in mealtimes. And we're going to ask him to participate in a consistent mealtime routine with positive control, where he leads the steps and learning at his own pace. John's mealtime routine is that we involve him in menu planning and we create the shopping list. His mum shops online, so he's able to pick the challenges for the week. We help him learn food preparation and we time meals and new challenges when he's regulated. So he tends to try new foods in the morning or on the weekends, because after a full day of school, he's too overwhelmed. During the meal, the person eating with John will give verbal prompts. And this makes me think, I haven't mentioned this in any of the other cases, but eating together is really important as a learning and social activity for any child who you're creating a routine from, because they learn from you and your reactions and how you manage food. We're going to look at high feedback food. We're going to define the steps to eating. So we have a defined steps to eating approach, which is from a specific feeding therapy program, which teaches John to tolerate, touch, look, and then taste and eat food. And we have a plan for how John can spit a food out if he's overwhelmed to keep him safe. This is going to be the last part of this presentation, and it's a video of John and I talking about what it's like for John's experience. So I'm going to play this video and then we'll be able to have a quick chat and move into the Q&A part of this presentation. Apologies, Melanie, I'm running a little bit over. So anyway, here's my chat with John. All our work was via telehealth, so that's why it's in this format that you will see. I won't talk to it, but I'll say something at the end.
All right, so Joey, thanks heaps for doing this. I really appreciate it. You're just such a wonderful young man that you can tell us about yourself.
Apologies, I talk very fast in real life, so I might stop and start every now and again to let our interpreters catch up.
All right, so Joey, thanks heaps for doing this. I really appreciate it. You're just such a wonderful young man that you can tell us about yourself. A lot of my clients can't, so I really appreciate you doing this. All right, so tell me a little bit about, one, your vision. Like, can you explain to us, you know, what your level of vision is? And also, can you explain to us, like, how you learned to eat, how you kind of navigate your world with that and anything else? Like, we talked a bit about some of the senses that you have or that don't go so well.
All right. Well, I can see nothing at all.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I've got no, like, light perception or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, it has been a bit hard to learn to eat.
Mm-hmm. What kind of things that you have? What kind of things have helped?
Well, just slowly getting into it, like having to feel the foods.
Uh-huh.
And not really being under stress.
Beautiful. Do you find like having a routine helps?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because what's it like when things kind of happen out the blue and you don't know they're going to happen? Does that make it?
Yeah, that's a bit more like stressful, if that's the right word.
Yeah. And how have you learned? Your mum said she's just put a fridge in your room. Like, how do you learn, like, where things are? Is it? And how to, like, help yourself to things?
Well, usually my mum puts them in the fridge.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, I just know where the fridge is on my desk.
Perfect, yeah.
And then, yeah, even the fridge out in the kitchen, I just go out there and grab what I need to eat.
Mm-hmm. You're doing so well with that yogurt, by the way. You're so neat and tidy. It's awesome. And so we talked a bit about your vision. What are the senses? Like, you don't have a sense of smell, right? We've talked about that.
Yeah, I don't have a sense of smell.
So when you taste, do things taste? Can you talk a bit about what things taste like? Like, what are you eating now? What flavor is that?
Well, I'd say it's chocolate.
Mm-hmm. Is it a big taste? Like, do you think of things in terms of,
I can taste it.
Yeah. Are there any foods you don't like because of their taste?
Probably not.
No, okay. And what are the... Sorry, go on.
Some foods, they don't really seem to have, like, much of a taste at all.
Interesting. And what do you want to get out of? We're about to start doing some work together. So let's talk about just quickly about what your goal has been doing feeding therapy with me. What's your big goal at the moment?
I want to be able to get back into eating like food.
Because what is it about food that's kind of making you feel uncomfortable?
Well, just because when I choked on that sausage, just all that bit of curried sausage, I just think I have like this fear of choking again.
Yeah, which makes heaps of sense. So we're going to use all of your tools in the box to help you get over that and to feel better about it. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to build you back up slowly at your pace. And we're going to do you remember the steps to eating? Do you remember what they are?
I'm going to pause it there just in the interest of time. But I really enjoy hearing John's experience, and this video highlights the importance of talking to children, older children, when creating routines. A few of the elements in John's video was around predictable routines and strategies, but also predictable placement of items. So the fridge is on his desk in his room. The fridge in the kitchen is in the same place, but the food's on the shelf in the fridge are the same. And so he's got that trust and safety in his environment to be able to have more control over it. Okay. So at the end, there's some of the references and resources at the end of this presentation where you can find out more information and that cover the key elements of what I've talked about today. There's some more there. And here's the contact details for Deafblind Information Australia. So I think I'm going to hand over to Melanie now, who's going to lead the Q&A. I'm so sorry, Melanie. I talked too long. It's because I normally talk faster. I think you're on mute, Melanie.
Thanks for that reminder. I was on mute. Thank you very much, Emma, for your presentation. It's good, as a speech pathologist myself, it's good to get a reminder of some of those things. And I think it also sort of highlights for me various processes of various stages of this eating process, and I'd probably like to make a few comments on reflecting back on different things and looking at the interpretation. So there might be an interpretation from one field or one discipline that explains why you're seeing certain behaviours. But I think in deaf blindness, you've always got to cast the, okay, so could we interpret that behaviour from a lack of vision point of view and or a lack of hearing point of view or the dual sensory impairment kind of point of view? Going back right to even their experience of eating and their understanding of what eating is and what it's for and how people do it. Maybe if we could stop the slide share for now, we'll pop that back later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sure.
So if you can't see people eating, how do you develop a concept of what people do and how they engage in mealtimes and you know, that they chew and they lick their lips and just the processes that you might actually be learning from seeing someone do it or hearing them talk about it. So that time of how do you then compensate from a hearing vision point of view, the mealtime experience? And I think that time in close contact, physical contact with people who are actually eating themselves. So you get to feel the food, you get to feel that they put it in their mouth, you get to feel that their jaw moves around. And the number of children maybe with physical disability and or deaf blindness that don't actually get to experience other people eating because it all happens outside the realms of their perception. So like filling in those really early experiences and getting people to, you know, get you feel pieces swallowed and just absorbing aspects of the mealtime process through touch, or maybe that's through closer proximity because they can't see it if they're across the other side of the dining table, that maybe they need to be really in close proximity. Even the concepts around where does food come from? For a lot of deafblind children, food is something that appears out of the air and lands in their mouth often, particularly if they don't have the physical skills to guide that. So how do we develop, you know, are we actually giving them time to experience the touch and the motion of somebody else raising a spoon to their mouth or following somebody else's hand to their own face to realise, that's actually coming from you. And I think I saw in Bella's video, Mum did a nice little kind of squeeze, I think, on her shoulder to kind of indicate it's mummy here. I'm interpreting, I don't know Bella and I don't know any of these clients, but it's mummy here. And then the little touch cue to go, and now something's coming towards your mouth. But even, you know, for some children, the fact that, yeah, I know something's coming, but for some, I still actually need to know what. You need to be more specific about what, or give me time to work out what is coming. Is it food? Is it drink? Is it the food that I had in the mouthful before? Is it something that I had last week? Is it something new? All these things can cause anxiety around mealtimes and possibly lead to this defensiveness, which some people say is a sensory defensiveness, but it may actually be the fact that they haven't been oriented to the mealtime or what is happening or what is coming, or that they were expecting something else. They were expecting the meal that they had earlier this morning, or they're expecting the same dinner that they had last night and it was different. So there's maybe, if there's not the understanding of why that might be different because they're different foods and we cook different things every night, then that might cause anxiety, not related to the fact that I can't tolerate it, but the fact that I wasn't expecting that and now I'm not sure what's going on and I feel anxious. So
I think that's a really good point, yeah. Melanie, and it's like we talk a lot about the patterns that have grown around eating and drinking, and if every single mealtime you don't know what's coming, it's always different, and as you say, that can lead to what looks like sensory defensiveness, but it's such an easy thing to fix with consistent routines and strategies.
Yes.
And then we have these children that are accepting food when they never have before because they know what it is, they know that it's coming.
Yeah.
I used to do an exercise with carers and teachers where I would blindfold them and have someone feed them yogurt in silence.
Yep.
And they all found it really confronting. So I would ask people to think about how they would feel if that was them, I think.
Yep. And how, you know, a child is oriented, that's going to be, again, different, because some are disabled, have a degree of functional vision. So we may actually be able to do a few tweaks about what we can see, you know, whether that's the lighting, whether it's the distance from them, whether it's the colours that we choose, whether it's the contrasting background that we choose to make those things actually more visible to them. If they don't have that degree of functional vision, we go, okay, well, we can't use their vision to do this. Maybe we're going to have to rely on touch, and them actually being oriented through a lot more experience of touching things before those things ever come to them and touch them. So they're in control of that sort of touch, or even touching others while they're eating, and understanding that process and how other people eat. I loved your point about sometimes the difficulty of getting information about vision and sound. So what sound is this child accessing? Well, if they're not wearing their hearing aids, so what actually can they hear? And are my verbal prompts, or am I, you know, verbal explanations going to even reach them? Or maybe they do in a quiet environment, but then when we're noisy at school or in kindy, none of these verbal or auditory prompts are going to be meaningful because they just can't access them in noise. I think the orthoptist is a great person to seek out. So they're kind of like an allied health professional in vision, do a four-year degree around assessment of vision, but also helping you understand how that person uses the vision that they do have, and whether there's things that we can do to actually support the use of that vision as well. And it'll give you kind of a bit better insight about what they might and might not be seeing, and how to help them see more or use the vision that they do have. Because sometimes it might be, as you say, that I put so much on my food, on my fork, because I can't actually see how much is going on. Or if I load my spoon with only a little bit of food, then I'm going to have to go back and, you know, lots of times to get more food. Or if some of that little bit of food falls off my fork or falls off my spoon, then, you know, I just got to start the whole process again. So actually, it's just better if I put a whole heap in there. So sometimes it can be a vision point of view that is driving some of the behaviours, not necessarily a reduced sensory, like, you know, I only notice that there's food in my mouth when there's a load of food in my mouth. And certainly it might be a combination of both of those. But I think we've always got to cast our view. Could vision be playing a role in this? Could the lack of hearing be playing a role in what we're seeing? And then around the point of seating, so like prescribed seating systems often provide a lot of postural support, which produce a great, a much safer swallow and eating experience. But we also need to recognise the time that maybe that deafblind child needs to be in physical proximity with someone during the eating process, maybe not their own eating process, but the process of other people, so that they build that concept development. Because in supported seating, sometimes some of those experiences are not accessible to them. I think that was sort of some of my reflection there. So thank you, but thanks for indulging me there. I was reflecting on, I think it was Zoe, the first video that you're showing, and reflecting on, you know, I think she's using these principles of orientation. Like I noticed she was hugging her bowl, which is a slightly unusual behavior, I guess, for people who could see, or maybe people who, maybe more common to people who had reduced sort of motor skills or a little bit of incoordination, but also for somebody who might have difficulty finding their bowl, particularly if it's a pale bowl on a pale tabletop. It's like, oh, well, if I don't hold on to that bowl nice and closely, I can feel, if I do hug it, then I can feel where the bowl curves around. I can feel the end point and the close point and the far point of the bowl. I know exactly where that is. And so now, therefore, I know exactly where to place my fork to get food. Whereas if they don't hug the bowl and they're going, then they're almost reaching into the void to find their bowl. So I like the little, you know, orientation strategy that she introduced there. And then another video, you could kind of see the high contrast bowl. So there was this strong purple bowl with pale coloured food in it, and it sat on a yellow tabletop or a yellow placemat. So again, that use of contrast to go, okay, well, this will help you see the food as well. But we can't always set that up. So again, it's always, you know, introducing these little orientation mobility strategies, either herself or she's learned them from someone, to help her be more independent and understand, you know, understand her mealtime experience.
And it's interesting with Zoe, because whilst that strategy of hugging the bowl and being down is something that she uses to help access and orientate, for her, it's not so safe because her chin tucks and she can't protect her airway when she swallows as well. So with Zoe, it's about teaching her the steps of orientating for the food, picking the food up and putting it to my mouth, as opposed to continuing this. Yeah. So that shows how, like, the different elements of access and safety need to work together a little bit as well, which is really interesting with her, I think. Mm.
And juggling all those different needs is really, really hard job, and a process that you might, you know, chip away at in layers. So I am going to hand over, I'm going to open this up to our audience. So thank you. I can see the questions starting to roll in. Thank you very much. We could ask that if you if you had questions, put them in the Q&A, which you've been doing, rather than the chat. If you have, if you're an Auslan user and you want to ask a question, just put Auslan in the Q&A, and I will turn the camera on for you so that you can sign your question. So the first one is a comment, I think, rather than around the question. Great. So on the subject of verbal cues when eating, Emma once made an observation in a session that we were asking lots of questions and guided us to make statements about what was happening rather than posing questions.
Yeah, that's say what you see, and thinking about why. The underlying reason why we're giving the cue to help the child orientate and feel safe and know what's happening. It's a lovely example. Thank you, Natasha.
And for those who maybe don't have auditory access, how do you make comments and talk, you know, provide interaction through the mealtime? And often that comes through touch and touching things together and acknowledging each other's touch. So if they reach for the spoon, you tap their hand, you tap and you feel the spoon together, it's like, oh yeah, I can see you reaching for the spoon. Or there's a spoon here, you know, let me put it in your hand and let's explore the spoon together, so that you're getting a sense of, oh, here's the spoon, but you also know that your communication partner or your mealtime partner is understanding and seeing you explore the spoon at the same time. So you've got this common understanding about the spoon and that common experience of the spoon.
And that also shows, I think, the importance of, one, really knowing your child and your child's access to different senses, and modifying them in that way to give the most information as well. I've often also done things like tapping the spoon on something, which I think you're going to chat to in a minute with the next example that Natasha gives. So the child can feel the vibration or the tap. So they might not be able to hear it or see it, but they can feel it, which is another way of doing it as well. But I'll let you go through the comments, Melanie, and not jump too far forward.
Okay, in reference to close proximity, as mentioned by Melanie, lately when my son sits on my lap while I eat, he hears the spoon tapping on my bowl and reaches out to feel my hand, bringing the spoon to my mouth and intercepts it to try it himself. I keep my jaw against his cheek to allow him to feel my chewing. just some examples of way to demonstrate eating differently. Lovely. Thank you very much for sharing that. And it's beautiful to have these insights from families who are living and breathing this stuff every day. Our next comment, because we only have 5 minutes left of the webinar. Fabulous presentation. The process from birth to toddler was really impactful. You mentioned 0 to 24 months as being so important. If a child has been terribly ill and has missed that critical period for various reasons, you said it's difficult but not impossible to get that happening again. I really liked your strategies around consistent routines and strategies. Thanks again. Yeah, so
you're not welcome. A question,
but more of a comment. Was there anything else you wanted to add there, Emma? Any more comment there?
No, thank you. Yeah, I think that I can see, because I can see the questions coming. There's one after that which I'll talk to, which will explain a little bit more. The key thing is that it's not impossible to get it happening again. We just need to consider the pattern that's been laid down through trying to learn to eat and drink whilst being unwell or not being able to tolerate eating and drinking, and how we can create a new one, which is often doing something completely different than has been done before and doing a completely different routine than has happened before as well.
Next one is a question. My question is around older preschoolers who miss that time of oral explanation. How do we get little ones willing to put things in their mouth at all, way before food?
It's a really good question. The key words in this is way before food. So we need to consider all the steps that we need to feel to be able to want to put something in your mouth. So we need to look at understanding the object is there. We want to be doing non-food items such as toy, or as in Bella's case, we do positive touch, because these children have learnt when things go in their mouth, it doesn't feel pleasant and they don't enjoy it. And so we need to rewrite that pattern to touch and interaction with my mouth is something that I want to happen and I will enjoy it. You'd work really closely with an OT probably around this, and looking at areas of the body where the child does accept touch and objects. So for example, using the Z vibe on the hands and the feet before working up to the mouth in a predictable routine in the same way every day. We'll do, when it comes to introducing food, we'll do steps with food such as interacting with food, smelling food, touching food. In any way of exploration or building safe patterns around food, it's always the child's choice when anything goes in their mouth, and they learn that they have positive control and are able to guide the process, and it always goes at their pace. And every situation is a positive learning experience as opposed to having something done to them. And we're going to use all the child senses and all the compensatory strategies we've talked about to help them access positive experiences and things going in their mouth. And so we'll look at the daily routine and think, where are we most likely to have success? So, for example, before Bella and I worked with food, she did things in the bath because she felt comfortable and relaxed in the bath. So we got her used to having touch on her face with a wet washcloth before we moved to food. So there's some examples. I'm sure, Melanie, you've got some more strategies there.
Yeah, and I think, you know, that whole idea of play for a child with deafblindness is often play with another person, not so much play with another object, because there's that uncertainty about and what is that object and where's it come from, and I've never experienced this before. So maybe the person is actually another person is actually a much better toy and play partner than an object, and particularly, you know, early on after those children maybe have come out of intensive care and have had tubes and all sorts of things in their mouth, which has built up that association that stuff in my mouth is unpleasant. So, you know, maybe it's fingers. Maybe we play with our fingers, and my fingers go in my mouth and your hands come with me, and we realize that fingers can go in our mouth. So then we do fingers, and then there might be other things on our fingers that then end up in our mouth. So that sort of playfulness and around exploring maybe someone else's mouth and what goes in it might then translate back to a curiosity about what might come, you know, going into their mouth. But I think it's all about trying things and trying to think through that individual's child experience and the people around them and how they can support that and what ideas they might come up with that understanding of, I can't see you put stuff in your mouth, maybe, and how we're going to translate that into another sense. Okay, couple more things. I think I think we'll just try and finish off here. There's a couple more comments, and then in that, while I'm doing that, Emma, could you share the slides again, because somebody would like to look at the references, and then perhaps you can move to the end slide, which is the feedback slide. So while people are listening to the end of the webinar, they might get that QR code on a mobile phone or some other device and start filling in our feedback for the webinar. That would be fantastic. So there's a question here. Do you have specific strategies for a child who is happy to put puree in their mouth, but teaching safe eating of food for someone with no access to vision or hearing for speech? We are seeing a mouth held wide open once food touches the lips.
It's obviously really hard to give non-specific advice, but I would be interested to know in terms of how they've become happy to put purees in their mouth. Are you using any touch cues or any smell cues or any other methods? I would probably go to touch cues here and be doing a little 1, 2, 3 under the chin or at the side of the mouth. I'm just reading, but teaching safe eating of food. I'm wondering if they're swallowing with their mouth wide open, or if it, when they swallow, you could do a touch cue to show that that's what's happening. In terms of managing more solid foods, for a child like this, I'd probably look at making the purees thicker and mashed to start teaching that round and round movement. But you'd probably need to work with a speech pathologist and get an assessment on that child's level of oral skills before I would recommend strategies to move them along across textures, because I think it's a little bit outside of the scope of this webinar. But I guess my advice for this type of thing would be to consider all the different senses you can use to give the cue that we need to close our mouth. And use touch and smell, particularly in this case, if they don't have any access to vision or hearing. I'd be looking at getting a speech pathologist involved to help them learn to move through textures in partnership with occupational therapy and vision and hearing specialists as well.
Great. Thanks, Emma. And the last one is, if we could have the feedback slide on screen now, that would be great.
Yes, sorry.
our audience to start filling that in. You will, when you leave the webinar, you will also get a prompt pop up via Zoom. It is in a little window and will give you the option to follow the link to provide the feedback there as well. And our last one is not a question, just a thanks to your reflection, Melanie, lots of ideas. Thank you, Emma. Lovely to have this webinar today as I write processes for mealtime management. Love safety with access. Great. Okay, so thank you so much, Emma. I know these things take a lot of effort and preparation, and the inclusion of videos is wonderful too, because we also have a hard time doing that, getting that permission and families to feel comfortable to, you know, have their child on screen and be looked at by, you know, by others. Another comment here, fantastic training, thanks so much. So lovely, thank you, Emma. Audience, this webinar is recorded. We will add the captions back in shortly, and it will be available on our website, and you will be notified via the emails that you registered on. So you can watch again or share with others. Right, and thank you very much. I hope we'll see you at our next webinar or maybe workshops. Bye. Thanks. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Thanks so much for having me, and thanks to all the families that allowed their stories to be told as well in the case study. Take care.